Hello, and welcome to this video on energy analysis in pulsed laser welds. To begin with, let me start by sharing the screen so you can follow along with the PowerPoint that I'm going to share. My name is Girish Kelkar, and I am a welding consultant operating as WJM Technologies. Additional information about my consulting business is on the web at welding-consultant.com, and you're watching this YouTube video on this YouTube channel at Weld Nugget. In this video, we're going to review energy analysis of pulsed laser welds. So we are going to look at the energy which is delivered to the weld, energy which is used for melting, and what happens to the rest which is not used for melting. For this reason, we have conducted a small test. Here we have used two materials for comparison. Aluminum 1100, which is almost essentially pure aluminum, and steel 1045, which is essentially carbon steel with about 0.45% carbon. Both materials were used in a plate form. So this is not actually welds. This is actually a spot on a solid plate. The spot was produced by a YAG laser, which operates at 1 micron, and you will see the reasoning behind the importance of that wavelength in a few slides. The spot, the parameters were, it was a 0.5 millimeter spot size, 4 kilowatts of peak power, and 3 milliseconds of a square pulse. What that means is, when we turn the laser on, the laser goes up to 4 kilowatts, is there for 3 milliseconds, and turns off. So it's like what is called a square pulse. The total energy input in this pulse would then be 4 kilowatts times 3 milliseconds, which is 12 joules. So the laser in every spot it makes is providing 12 joules of energy. These are the two cross sections which were made through the center line along the diameter of the spots, and where we can see that the depth of welding in aluminum for the same amount of energy is only 0.2 millimeters, whereas the depth of melting or fusion zone in steel is 1 millimeter. So we can obviously see a big difference in the volume of the two. Now we want to analyze how much energy would be required to melt this volume of aluminum as compared to the volume of steel. And for that, we'll need to use the energy equations. So energy for melting is the energy for heating the component from 20 degrees to the melting point. So this is just to warm it up to the melting point. And energy for fusion, that means the energy required to convert from the melting point from solid state to liquid state. So that is only to melt from solid to liquid. The energy for melting is given by the expression mass times heat capacity times difference in temperature. So in this case, we are going to melting point. So we are taking the difference between melting point and room temperature, which we are assuming at about 20 degrees centigrade. The energy for actual melting is mass times heat of fusion, which is in units of joules per gram. The numbers which we get from literature include the heat capacity, melting point of the two different materials, and heat of fusion for the two different materials. So these numbers we get from literature. What we need is we need the mass of molten metal. For that, we're going to start with the volume of molten metal and multiply by the density. In this analysis, we are assuming that the material reaches the melting point, but not much higher. So we are saying that during this process, the material heats up from room temperature to melting point, melts, and that's pretty much it. It doesn't go much beyond that. Now, that's not a, that's a reasonable assumption, because what happens is during the melting heating process, the temperature increases. Once it starts melting, the heat is transferred down into the bulk and you produce a volume of molten metal. Now, that volume of molten metal, even though it is at a high temperature, it is also quickly losing heat by conduction. And that keeps the molten metal from going too high in temperature. Of course, it still depends on the peak power. And if the peak power is very high, you can get boiling and a lot of spatter. But in this case, we did not get a lot of spatter, though it looks like it might be on the verge of it based on these swirls over here. Now, these are porosities which are formed due to that effect of swirling around. So they might be on the verge of getting a little bit hard. The volume of fusion metal can be calculated. Looking at the cross sections, I have approximated the cross section to be in the type of a triangle, both for aluminum and steels. Measured the base of the triangle and height of the triangle based on the scale on these pictures. And the volume of that cone, which will form for fusion, would be pi times the radius square, radius of the base square, multiplied by the height, divided by 3. Once we get the volume, you multiply it by density to get the mass of the molten metal or the metal which actually melted and now it's solid. We take all those numbers, put it into an Excel spreadsheet, and do the math. Here we have the mass. The mass of aluminum obviously is much, much smaller because, first of all, the volume of molten, the metal which melted is small for aluminum, and the density is also much less than steel. Then we have the density, heat capacity, melting point of aluminum and steel. And here we notice the difference, which we will point out again later on, is the melting point of aluminum is only 660. Melting point of steel is 1540, much greater. Heat of fusion, we do all the math based on this equation, and we find that the energy which would have been required to melt that small volume would be 0.063 joules, whereas energy for melting that volume for steels is 1 joule. And the total input energy for both was always was equal at 12 joules. So the percent heat of the input energy, which is actually used for melting, is only 0.5% for aluminum and about 10% for steel. Now, that might come as a surprise to you, but it's not uncommon in welding. A lot of the energy might be lost in transmission, as well as how it is absorbed. And this is especially unique, a bit more unique for laser welding than other processes. And let's see what how the absorption affects welding. Here is a chart showing reflectivity on the vertical axis on the scale of 0 to 1. So 1 is 100% reflective, this is 0% reflective. On the horizontal axis is the wavelength, and we can see it goes from 0.2 to 10. And I have shown 4 different lasers which are commonly used for welding, or 4 different wavelengths which are commonly used for welding. So on the extreme right is 10 micron, which is CO2. And you will notice that CO2 is reflective for pretty much all metals. At 1 micron, the situation is a little bit better. We have 1 micron is common wavelength for YAG, fiber, and disc lasers. Again, it's not exactly 1 micron. It's 1.064, 1.07. But for this discussion, 1 micron approximation is fine. So at the 1 micron wavelength, and then we have the green laser at 0.55 microns and blue laser at about 0.4 microns. And we have all these curves for different metals. We have silver, palladium, platinum, which are all kind of very whitish looking metals, and they have good reflectivity for all wavelengths, blue, green, red, or infrared, 1 micron, and CO2. Copper is a bit unique, high reflectivity at 1 micron, but much lower reflectivity at blue. And that is why blue laser would be useful for welding copper. Aluminum is at about 0.8% reflective, 0.8 or 80% reflective. Again, these are at room temperature. And then steels is about 60% reflective. So aluminum is not absorbing as much. Aluminum is actually only absorbing 20% of the energy at room temperature. So at the start of the welding, whatever energy you're depositing into the aluminum surface, 80% is being reflected, only 20% is being absorbed. Steels are a little bit better at room temperature, about 40% is absorbed. And that does make a difference. So even though that seems very low compared to, say, 100%, it is still a significant improvement over aluminum. As the energy is absorbed, the material starts to melt. And as the materials melt, the absorptivity increases. So a greater fraction of incident energy is being absorbed on molten metal compared to solid metal. But that still doesn't go close to 100%. Even in deep keyhole mode welds, the absorption is somewhere in the order of 70 to 80%. So, and in this case, we are not making keyhole. We are almost in the conduction mode, maybe slightly bordering onto keyhole in steel. So even in the molten condition, our absorption is going to be of the order of, say, 50% or 60%, fairly low. So you'll notice that a lot of the energy that you're supplying into the weld is actually being reflected. Close to 50% is already lost. So we are supplying 12 joules of energy, and somewhere of the order of, say, 30 or 40% to 50% is being lost for both steel and aluminum. Here I'm showing you a schematic looking at the energy balance. So here I'm showing you a schematic of a laser beam coming down. It is focused down to a spot size. This red region is the beam coming down. This is a cross section of the metal. We're showing a volume of molten metal which is formed during welding. As we have seen in the previous slide, a lot of the energy is actually lost by reflection. The remainder is absorbed. So when laser is incident on metal, some of it is reflected, some of it is absorbed, but there is no transmission. The laser light does not transmit through either molten metal or solid metal. So all the energy is either reflected or absorbed. So we looked at energy reflected on the previous chart. Now we're going to think about energy absorbed. So once the energy is absorbed, what does that energy do? The energy creates a volume of molten metal. And we saw that in this analysis and in the cross section that we are seeing molten metal in the cross section. This is of course solidified now, but at some point in time during welding, these volumes were molten. But in addition to that, we are also expecting a lot of energy loss. Now, energy is going to be lost by radiation, by convection, because all the welds typically will have shielding gas. But the majority of energy loss is often by conduction. As this molten metal volume is created, it has a surface area over here, the surface that is the interface between solid, molten and solid materials, where a lot of energy is going to be lost into the solid, and the solid acts like a giant heat sink. So the absorbed energy, only a small amount is used for melting, and a lot of it is actually lost. And we can see that from the analysis. We are depositing about 12 joules. And in this reflectivity analysis, we saw that close to 50% is reflected. So only about 6 joules is absorbed. And out of that, only a small volume, a small quantity of that energy is actually being used for melting. The remainder of most of that 6 joules is going to be lost by conduction, radiation, and convection. Now the question comes is why is the steel fusion zone so much larger than aluminum? So here we can see the cross sections again. We notice that the volume of molten metal in aluminum is much smaller than that of steel. There are two reasons for that. The first is better absorption on steel than aluminum. And we saw that in the chart before that the absorption of 1 micron wavelength on steel is much better than in aluminum. So steel will absorb about 40% of the incident energy, and aluminum will absorb only 20% at the beginning. Even after melting, those numbers don't go to 100%. They might go to about 50% or 60%, but still, a lot of energy is still being lost to reflection. And then on top of that, steel has poor heat conductivity. So steel loses heat much more slowly or with great effort. So that is where the poor conductivity comes in. So conductivity of heat in steels is only 45. The units are watts per meter Kelvin, whereas conductivity of aluminum is 235, so almost 5 times. So what happens is the energy which is absorbed, and as the temperature rises, because aluminum is a good conductor of heat, a lot of that heat is lost very, very quickly. So it is very counterintuitive. You would think that if aluminum is a good conductor of heat, that heat would be dissipated and a larger volume of molten metal will be formed. But it's exactly the opposite. Because the heat is dissipated very quickly, local temperature does not rise to the melting point very easily for aluminum. Whereas steels is exactly the opposite. Steels are poor conductor of heat, so they kind of trap the heat which is there, and it doesn't lose that heat very quickly. And that is why it is much easier to melt steels compared to aluminum. Now, this is steel. Stainless steels are even have even poorer thermal conductivity, and it is all even easier to weld stainless steels with lasers. So this is very interesting. So we did an analysis of energy in terms of how much energy is coming in, how much is reflected, and we did some math over here to figure out how much is actually being converted to molten to melt the metals, and that is also different based on the volume of the two materials. And we saw the reason for that was steels have poor conductivity. And hence, even though steels have a much higher melting point, see, the melting point of steels over here is 1540 degrees centigrade compared to melting point of aluminum, which is only 660. So you would think it is so much easier to go to 660 from room temperature rather than going to 1540 from room temperature. But in laser welding, it is not so. The poor conductivity plays a bigger role than anything else. And that is why it is much easier to weld steels with laser than with aluminum. And you will find that by experience also. If you want to make a certain, say, volume of molten metal or fusion zone for steels, and let's say you are using a 1 kilowatt laser, you're going to find that if you want to make a comparable volume of fusion zone in aluminum, you might need a laser which is 3 or 4 kilowatts. And that is precisely because aluminum has poor absorptivity at 1 micron and also has very high conductivity, thermal conductivity. And that is the reason why aluminum is much more difficult to laser weld based on this heat balance and based on practical experience also. In summary, laser energy incident on a weld is either absorbed or reflected. On metals, there is no transmission of energy through the metal, either liquid or solid. So the energy is either reflected or absorbed. The amount absorbed depends on the wavelength. And we saw from this chart that if you use a different type of laser, the amount of absorption is going to be different. Only a small fraction is actually used for melting. Even though some of the energy is absorbed, only a small fraction of that is actually used for melting. The rest of it is lost to conduction, radiation, and convection. Of that, conduction actually plays the biggest role. So, and that's what results in the volume of molten metal being a balance between absorption and thermal conductivity. So, this balance, delicate balance between absorption and thermal conductivity, will decide how much of the volume of metal is going to melt. And that is going to be different for different metals. So you could send the same amount of energy into multiple different metals, and they could all have a different size of the fusion zone. In this case, we compared steels to aluminum, and we found that steels have a much greater absorption and lower thermal conductivity. And hence, even though steels have a much higher melting point, it was much easier to make a large fusion zone in steels with laser welding than with aluminum. Well, this is an interesting analysis of energy balance between melting and thermal conductivity. And now you have a clear idea of how to think about laser welding in terms of the material properties and how that affects the size and of the fusion zone. If you're new to the topic of laser welding, there are other useful laser welding videos in the laser welding playlist, including fundamentals of laser welding, types of welding lasers, laser beam quality, spot size in laser welding, pulse shaping, shielding gases, and conduction and keyhole modes. You might have heard me use the words conduction and keyhole mode. And if you are new to laser welding, definitely watch this video so you'll have a better understanding of the subject. Well, I want to thank you for your time. And if you're interested in learning more about welding and joining, please subscribe to this YouTube channel by clicking the subscribe button below. I have multiple other videos on different topics and different playlists on this channel, including arc welding, resistance welding, welding and metallurgy, welding design, and other welding processes. I hope you find all of those to be useful, and wishing you the very best in your efforts to learn more about welding. Thank you.